use your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. I don't wanna abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change.
Everybody, hope you guys are doing well. Welcome to week 3 of remote church at Faith Fellowship. If you're tuning in for the first time, welcome as well. Like I said, this is the third Sunday that we have been doing church online. We think it's going pretty well. We'd also love to hear your feedback. Please feel free to reach out to us and let us know what you thought about the service. It's fun doing church online and seeing the comments come through. And looking back at them afterwards and seeing that people enjoyed what was going on. On the topic of what's going on right now, we do hope you all are safe and staying healthy and isolated and quarantined, washing those hands and doing everything you can to help the country and the world beat this as quickly as we can. We do trust the Lord, but we also do have to be diligent in following not orders per se, but working as hard as we can to get rid of this so we can be together again. Church is pretty much, even though it is online, it has been normal the last couple weeks, and will continue to be through Good Friday. We will have a Good Friday service, and also Easter Sunday will looking like very likely be online. But we'd love for you to tune in. Like I said, everything's pretty normal. We've continued to do worship, still taking up an offering, which you can send into the church, or you can do that online as well. Still having Bible teaching. We're gonna open in prayer and get right into it. So let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we love you, we praise you, and we trust you in difficult times such as these. Be with the leaders of the world, Lord. Guide them in making decisions, and be with doctors and nurses and all healthcare, and be with all of us, Lord. Help us to put our faith in you and know that you know the outcome, and this is all in your hands. I pray that you would open our hearts this morning, Lord, and as we praise and worship you, that you would be glorified and that you would give us ears to hear and hearts to understand as we hear some teaching, and it's in your precious name we pray. Amen. I was writing down a couple notes this morning, and one of the first things I wrote that is, despite all that is going on and how tragic it may be, God is still good. And then I crossed out the word good and wrote great and circled it a few times. So we're not going to sing how good thou art, we're going to sing how great thou art. Familiar hymn. So join me, if you would, in how great thou art.
And I
This morning, as we do a quick guitar change, was that not only are we to continue praising the Lord and worshiping Him in times such as these, but all of creation does. I love, actually, what Seth's going to talk about today, during the triumphal entry when the Pharisees ask Jesus, or tell Jesus to tell the people praising Him to be quiet, he says, I tell you that if these were to be quiet, then the very rocks themselves and stones would cry out. And the psalmist writes in Psalm 98, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth, break forth into joyous song and sing praise. Sing praise to the Lord with the lyre, the sound of the melody, the harp, the trumpets, and the horn. Make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. So he's talking to people there, you know, telling us to praise the Lord. But then he goes on to talk about creation doing the same thing. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell in it. Let the rivers with joy clap their hands, and let the hills sing for joy together before the Lord. For he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the people with equity. So this Psalm 98 song is taken directly out of that chapter of the Bible. We've sung it once or twice. So if you don't know the words, just turn to Psalm 98 and it's pretty spot on.
Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, the fullest salvation he brings. Shout with joy to trumpet and harp sing.
Songs that are taken straight out of scripture. It gets me excited to just be singing the word of God to a beautiful melody. So like I said, we are doing church as similarly to normal as possible, despite the fact that I'm here in my bedroom and you guys are in your living rooms or wherever you may be. But we are still taking up an offering. As I said before, now more than ever is a time to give, because people need it. The church needs money to give to our ministries as usual, and people are in dire need right now. So I also just wanted to read a little brief something related to that. Again, from the triumphal entry in the book of Luke, chapter 19, when Jesus is coming in to Jerusalem. As he was drawing near, already on the way down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." So I read that a little bit, or I talked about that a little bit before. One of the parts that it doesn't mention in Luke is that people laid their coats and their or palm branches down at Jesus' feet when he came. And I think it's cool that they were, a lot of people were misinformed, as you know. They thought they did not know exactly who Jesus was. They were not quite sure who was coming, why he was coming. they thought he was coming to be their savior instead of, while he was, they did not know he was coming to die. Anyway, nonetheless, they gave what they had, whether it was they grabbed palm branches, or they took their coats off their backs, or from their homes and laid those down. Anyway, I just thought that was cool. So let's give thanks for our offering at this time. Heavenly Father, we do again trust you in this time of need and maybe we time of trouble, Lord. Maybe we feel like it may be hard to give right now, but we just thank you that every good and perfect gift comes from above, and that we would like to be gracious with what you've given us and give back to you, Lord. We pray that with whatever we give to church, it is used for your glory and for good for those who need it, Lord. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Like I said, obviously we're not passing a basket around, but if you would like to send your offerings, and you can send them into church, our address is 4375 Ebenezer Road, and that is Nottingham, Maryland. Zip code is 21236, I believe. Yep. Or you can do it online, FFCPH, that's Faith Fellowship Church, Perry Hall, so FFCPH.org, O-R-G. We do thank you for that as well. So let's continue singing. We sang this song last week, and we got to sing it one time, I think, as an actual body together, King of Kings. Like I said, the last couple times we sang it, it's a little wordy. There are a lot of words, so many words that I'm going to have to scroll through on my computer halfway through the song, so bear with me. But I love the descriptions it gives of the week that we're going to be talking about, Jesus coming into Jerusalem and dying and finally rising from the dead. So this is King of Kings. Let's sing this together.
Gospel truth of all shall not be shattered.
down what's going on in the world, but we just ask that you would help us to trust you, Lord. We don't know what's going to happen, but we know that you know, and that should be enough. Pray that you would ask us to, or we ask you that you would just help us to know that, to be still and know that you are God. I would say beautiful singing, but I don't know how you guys sounded in your living rooms. I'm just kidding. We are going to go to Seth now, who is at church, I believe. He wanted to preach from the building this morning, as far as I know. So he's going to go through some scripture with us, do some teaching, and we'll come back and sing a couple songs together at the end. So we'll see you in a few minutes.
Well, good morning, Faith Fellowship Church. Thank you for that wonderful time in worship, Alex. And I know as we continue to meet in this new and different way that it's still an adjustment, but I hope you are finding ways to worship and to enjoy the company of the body of believers here at Faith. I know as I watched last week on Facebook, it was great to see everybody typing and saying hello to each other and staying in communication. I know it's been something that's tough, but the more we stay in touch, the more we find new ways to stay in touch, it will help us through this process. You know, if you have a prayer request, type it in the comments as you're watching on Facebook, and let's pray for each other, and let's lift each other up during this hard time. You know, and it's going to be even a little more weirder as we approach this time in the church calendar. As we approach this Easter season, knowing that we cannot gather as a body for Easter. You know, and we begin that today as we look at Palm Sunday. And then on Friday, as we look to Good Friday. And then on Sunday, as we'll gather online and worshiping the empty tomb. You know, it's something that is hard for us to adjust. But we know that God is in control. We know that God reigns over everything. And whether we meet here online or we meet in person, we know that God is still working. And it's with that I am glad and joyful to be here with you today, to be opening up the scriptures and looking at this Palm Sunday. You know, if we were worshiping in this room together, as I look around to an empty room, and don't worry, I'm not breaking any laws. We did see that even though we are under a stay-at-home order, that pastors and church leaders could come into church for reasons of a worship service. So here I am, not breaking the laws, so don't worry about that as you watch me here this morning. But we would be together in this room waving our palm branches, waving our branches in celebration of our coming King. Today marks the beginning of the Passion Week of Christ. He comes into Jerusalem riding on a donkey, celebrated by the crowd. You know, it's a week that begins with celebration. It moves into a time of sadness and fear, but then it ends again with great celebration. I hope that you join us for these next three services as we look again at Palm Sunday today, then as we look to the cross on Friday, and as I said, as we look to the empty tomb on Sunday. Now, as we get ready to look into this idea of what happens on Palm Sunday, I invite you to turn to Matthew 21, and I'll read the passage for us for today. But before I do, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, again in a different way. Lord, we try and make sense of what is happening in the world around us, but we know that you are in control. Lord, we ask that you would be with those on the front lines, the nurses and the doctors, those who are trying to save people's lives. We ask that you would keep them safe, keep their families safe. Lord, we also pray for those who have lost loved ones. Lord, we can't imagine the pain and the suffering that they are dealing with losing a loved one to the virus. But Lord, we ask that you would extend your hand of comfort to them, that they might feel your peace. And Lord, and we pray for those of us who are in our homes. Lord, give us the ability to focus on you. Help us to drown out the noise of the world, but to set our eyes and our hearts on Christ. Lord, be with me as I bring forth your word today. Lord, we're thankful for this time of Easter, for this time of Palm Sunday and of Good Friday. Lord, be with us today. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's hear from the word. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey and a colt. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, 'Behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a colt, the foal of the beast of burden.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put them on their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread out their cloaks on the ground. Others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the ground as well. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he had entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up. "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." Here it is, Jesus' great entry into the city of Jerusalem. But as we examine this event today, I want to take a deeper look and look into two things. I want to look at what the Jews expected from their Messiah. And also, I want to investigate this idea of these crowds which were gathering around Jesus throughout his ministry, and how all these things come together on Palm Sunday. So first, let's dive into what the Jews expected from their Messiah. The nation of Israel, as we know, if you've gone through the Old Testament, has a rocky history. From being slaves in Egypt to wandering in the wilderness, they had a tough journey. They had this land, this hope of promise through Abraham, and they were chasing after it, wandering so long in the desert. But after much inner turmoil and fighting of foreign enemies, they would enter into their land, and they would settle into it. And they would have much success in their land. But their relationship, as we know, was going up and down with God. They would have great success with their promised King David and his son Solomon. But after Solomon, the nation would be split, and they would even fight against each other. Over time, God would use foreign leaders to punish his people for their sins, and they would even be taken out of their land. But they would return. However, their return would be under a foreign power, not ruling themselves. And in spite of all this, they held on to one hope, the hope of the struggle of their foreign invaders. They were under the rule of the Persians, of the Greeks, and now the Romans, but it was that hope of Messiah, the hope of something greater that would rescue them from their situation. You know, as you read a lot of the writings from outside biblical text, there's a lot of different ideas about this Messiah. But there are some things that mostly all agree on. And one of the first things that we see about Messiah that we see in our own scriptures is that the kingship line of David would be restored. They thought Messiah would come in and free their political situation. He would kick the Romans out of their land, and they would be a nation again. If you recall, throughout his ministry, The disciples were always asking Jesus. They were saying, at this time, are you going to restore the kingdom? They wanted their Messiah to be a political or military type leader who would deal with the external crises faced by the nation. But this isn't all they thought Messiah would be. They thought Messiah would also be a prophet, somebody similar to Moses or Elijah, something along those lines, a spokesperson for God. And we're going to see this in a little bit as we look later on in John chapter 4. But you see, there wasn't much thought to a suffering Messiah, one who would die for his people. This is one reason why whenever Jesus would kind of bring up this idea of his death, the disciples didn't really get it. They didn't really understand what was happening because it's not really what they pictured him to be doing. You see, over time, we learned through extra-biblical materials that fake messiahs had come and gone, given statements, and they had passed away. There was still this waiting for this long-awaited Messiah. Then, as we turn to the New Testament, Jesus enters the world. And right from the beginning, the world is faced with the question of, who is this child? Let's look at Matthew chapter 2 for verse 1. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king. Let's pause right there. We are introduced to King Herod. King Herod was ruling over Judea. While the Romans were the controlling empire, they still used local rulers to help implement and support Roman policy. And currently, he is in control. Let's see how this plays out. It says, born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who was born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose. We have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they go to their scriptures, what we know as the Old Testament, and they read the prophecies about this Messiah, and of course they learn that he is to be born in Bethlehem. The wise men from the east come seeking the one who had been born king of the Jews. This obviously troubles the current king. Is somebody now born that has a right to my throne? Herod wants the wise men to go to Bethlehem and worship this newborn king. But he says, you know what, come back to me on your way as you return home, because I want to go and worship this king as well. Of course, we know that he has different motives. And as the wise men travel to see Jesus and they present their gifts, they are told by God to not return to Herod. And in fact, Joseph and Mary are told to go down to Egypt to protect Jesus and the family. Because after a while, King Herod realizes that these wise men have not returned and that he has been tricked or forgotten and wants to do something. So he sends out messengers to have all baby boys 2 years and under killed in Bethlehem to try and put an end to this prophecy, to put an end to this would-be king of Israel. From the beginning, Jesus has caused people to wonder about him. With all this in mind, let's look at some more scriptures to see what was the thoughts going on in the time about this Messiah. One of the first things that we come to is some questioning of John the Baptist. Here in John chapter 1, and beginning in verse 19, we're told that priests and Levites are sent from Jerusalem to figure out what's this guy all about. They ask him, who are you? In verse 20, he says, I am not the Christ. They ask him then, what then? Are you Elijah? He says, no, I am not. Are you a prophet? He says, no. So they said to him, who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself? He says, I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah says. So they're asking him these questions. Questions to figure out, is this guy the Messiah? John says, no, no, I am not the Messiah. But he says, I am one calling out the way of the Lord. We know in another passage, he says, look, there is someone greater than me coming. All these questions from the Jewish leaders served a specific purpose. Is this guy the Messiah we've been waiting for? And of course, John quotes from the Old Testament. The Old Testament is what gave the picture, the prophecies about this Messiah. So we have seen a king seeking the Messiah. We have seen these priests and Levites seeking the Messiah. But what about others? What about the people of the time? What were they thinking? Well, as I mentioned before, John chapter 4, Jesus has this interaction with the woman at the well. And in verse 25, she says this. She says, I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. You see, a prophet would be somebody who would tell people all things. This Messiah, as we said before, would be a messenger, like Moses or Elijah, a true prophet of God. Deuteronomy 18:15 says, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you. It is you who shall listen to him. So we have seen a promised king, and that of a prophet who would come as Messiah. But there is another thing, an important part of the Messiah, and it is the signs he would perform. Hear the prophecy from Isaiah 35, verses 5 and 6. It says, then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute will sing for joy. Now, as John the Baptist goes on in his life, he ends up in prison. And while in prison, he's having doubts about Jesus. How could Jesus be the Messiah if I, the forerunner, in here, and I'm in prison? This doesn't make sense. So we pick up this story in Matthew chapter 11. John from prison has sent some of his disciples to Jesus and asked him, are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another? Now, keeping those words of Isaiah in mind, listen to what Jesus says. He says, go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is the one who is not offended by me. Jesus, with the disciples, tells John the Baptist, look at what I'm doing. Remember what the scriptures have said, the blind will see, the deaf will hear. I am the Messiah. Don't be offended by these things that I say. All this pointed to him being the long-awaited Messiah. In John 7:31, it says the people, as they were talking about Jesus, it says, many of the people believed in him. They said, when Christ appears, will he do more signs than this man has done? Is it even possible that somebody else might do signs more than what Jesus has done? He must be the Messiah. And it says that people believed in him. Now, at one point in the relationship between Jesus and the Jewish leaders, the scribes and the Pharisees in Matthew 12 demand a sign, as if they haven't seen enough already from him. But Jesus tells them that he'll give them a sign. He said it will be the sign of Jonah. He says, just as Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days, so the Son of Man will be in the earth 3 days. He is talking about his resurrection. He's saying, you want to see a sign? You're going to get one. And it's going to be me rising from the dead. Finally, toward the end of his ministry, the Jews gather again. And in John chapter 10, verse 22, they just ask him flat out. It says, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. Jesus responds by saying, I've already told you. He's not going to play their games. All this questioning, when it seems so obvious that Jesus was the Messiah. But remember, he didn't fit what they wanted for Messiah. He wasn't renewing some kingdom here for them. He wasn't some political hero here to rescue them from the Romans. Remember the words from Palm Sunday. King of Israel, son of David. The waving of the palms was a symbol of Jewish nationalism. It was of victory. We read from texts outside of Scripture that this is something that was done for great victories for the Jewish leaders, of a conquering hero. They cheered, again, for an external solution. They wanted salvation from their surroundings. They didn't understand that Jesus came to save the internal, to save them from the sins that affected them from the inside out. You know, one Christmas growing up, my cousin really wanted one of those Razor scooters. They were like the big gift of the time. So he was opening all of his gifts, like we were at my grandparents' house, I think, and just tearing through his present after present after present, seeing if he was going to get this scooter. The more it went on, I think it began to set in that there was no scooter in his pile. He had these great expectations. I'm going to get this great gift. But by the end, he was disappointed because he didn't get the gift that he wanted. He didn't get the gift that he expected to get. And he was hurt, disappointed. You see, the Jews were upset and disappointed. They weren't getting the Messiah that they wanted. They questioned Jesus. They ignored Jesus. They sought to arrest Jesus. He's making himself out to be God. He is not our Messiah. Today, how many of us seek that same external salvation from Messiah? Jesus, save me from my financial problems. Save me from my bad job. Save us from this virus. Save me from this addiction. All those things are things worth being saved from. But there is a deeper issue in life that Jesus came for. When we aren't saved from those physical issues, we act like we didn't receive the gift we wanted. We get angry and disappointed and upset. God, why didn't you save me? Why didn't you stop this? Why didn't I get what I wanted? But remember, Jesus came to save a bigger solution, the problem of sin. And that is what Messiah, Christ, would do. Hear the prophecy from Isaiah 53, one of the greatest prophecies about what Messiah would do. It says this, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. So as we think about Palm Sunday, we need to realize the real truth about the Messiah who was coming into Jerusalem that day. One who is not a political or military savior, but a savior from sin. Bill McDonald says this. He says, instead of appearing as a colorful military general, the Messiah had come as a lowly carpenter. His gentleness, lowliness, and humiliation were out of character with what the prevailing image of the militant Messiah. Men who were guided by fleshly desires might doubt his claim to kingship. But God's blessing would rest on those who by spiritual insight recognize Jesus of Nazareth as the promised Messiah. So the Messiah is an important part to Palm Sunday. But so is this crowd that had formed to give praise to Jesus. Where did this crowd come from? Why was this crowd there? In the four Gospels, the word crowd appears 123 times. I started to look into that as I was reading through our Bible plan. And going through the Gospels, I started to notice how many times that word crowd appeared in certain stories and throughout the Gospels. So, thankful to technology and not having to count every single one, I was able to do a quick search and realize, yeah, there was those 123 references to crowds around Jesus. And in Matthew chapter 4, verses 23 through 25, we get an idea, insight into why there was such commotion, why these crowds around Jesus. And in Matthew 4, it talks about Jesus going through and teaching in the synagogues, proclaiming the gospel. It says he was healing every disease and every affliction among the people. And in verse 25, it says his fame spread throughout the area. His name was great. And it goes on to say, then the great crowds followed him. They had heard what Jesus was doing. They heard the miracles he was performing, and they were attracted to that. They wanted to see maybe what Jesus would do next. This relates to our previous thought about all those signs Jesus was doing. People saw that, and they were attracted to it. Ironside makes note that many followed him, expecting that at any moment he might even overthrow the Roman power and bring deliverance to Israel. This is what all connects us with Palm Sunday. You know, some other examples as you kind of think about these crowds in the New Testament. In Matthew 5, before the Sermon on the Mount, we're told that seeing the crowd, Jesus went up on a mountain and taught to the people. In Mark chapter 2, Jesus is teaching at a house. And we're told that it's such a large crowd that these friends can't get their paralyzed friend to Jesus. So what do? They go up on the roof and they open up the roof and they lower their friend down to Jesus because it was the only way that they could see themselves getting through this crowd to see Jesus. In Mark chapter 5, with the healing of the woman who had been bleeding for 12 years, There is a great crowd as the people are walking in and disciples with Jesus. And in the midst of this crowd, this herd, it's almost like Jesus feels something. And he says, "Who touched me?" And his disciples are like, "Jesus, what are you talking about? All these people are around us. You're bumping into people every 2 seconds. And you're going to ask, who touched you?" These crowds were large. I kind of picture it like a Ravens game. If you've ever been to a Ravens game and you come out of the stadium after the game and you kind of sometimes if you take the light rail, you walk across the bridge to the light rail and oftentimes you're walking like this next to people. Not proper social distancing, but you know. So you're walking down and then you get into the light rail and you're standing like this. And if I were to ask one of my friends or whoever I'm with, if I'm with Christy, and say, "Hey, who touched me?" They're like, "What are you talking about? You're bumping into people all the time." This is what it was like in that moment. Later on in Luke chapter 19, we see another crowd. Now, this is a problem I'm not familiar with because I'm a tall man. But Zacchaeus was short, and he couldn't see over the crowd. He couldn't see Jesus. So, you know, if you know the song that he climbed up in that sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. We see these pictures throughout this, of this crowd, of these people following Jesus. And in almost all the references, we don't get any picture of numbers. But we do get two pictures of numbers in two certain events. And if you know them, they are the feeding of the 4,000 and then also the feeding of the 4,000. Or did I say them both? The 5,000 and the 4,000. But we know that these are not exact numbers. we know from Scripture it says that that counted the men. It didn't include the women and the children. Some estimates say that these crowds could have been as many as 8 to 10,000 people. I think it's fair to say in our common times that Jesus was not good at social distancing. We would not have been happy to see 10,000 people walking around following Jesus. I'm just saying, there's a virus, it's what's going on. But here, Jesus is feeding these large crowds. And as I continue to look in these passages, I started to realize that, you know, all these crowds following him, you would think there would be a lot of mentioning of those coming to know Jesus, to believing in Jesus. And you know, within those passages, there are some that talk about, and some believed, and many believed in him. But as I noticed, there was also a lot that made no mention of anyone believing in Jesus. And in Matthew chapter 9 and Mark chapter 6, they give similar statements of Jesus looking out over the crowd and having compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. They were lost. You see, these great crowds were sure following Jesus, but were they following him? Remember, Jesus' call to his disciples were, "Follow me." Jesus addresses this issue in John chapter 6 after feeding the 5,000. The crowd had gathered again, but not because they wanted Jesus, but because they wanted food. They wanted more bread from Jesus, and Jesus rebukes them in John 6:26, and he says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because of the signs you saw, but because you ate your fill of the loaves." Our small group is currently going through the book of John in a study by Tony Evans. It's actually on Right Now Media, so if you kind of have some time on your hands, like I know you all do, check it out. It's actually filmed in Baltimore. But as Tony was checking out this passage, he said this. He said, "The gift was more important than the giver to these people." He says they didn't want a savior, they wanted provision. It's all similar to the Messiah questions as well. People only wanted external help. They were hungry, they wanted food. All the crowd wanted was gifts from Jesus. As it continues, Jesus would tell the crowd that he has way more to offer than just physical bread. He tells them that he is the bread of life, and that whoever comes to him will never thirst and never be hungry. He goes on to say that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. But it was after all this, at the end of John chapter 6, that many turned their back and they leave Jesus because it was too hard what he was saying. Jesus, meet my physical need, not my spiritual need. It wasn't wrong for them to be hungry. It wasn't even wrong to them to look to Jesus for help. But they wanted Jesus to serve their purpose, to serve their needs. The large crowd gathered, excited by what Jesus was doing, but not really interested in changing their lives and believing in Jesus as their Messiah. Which brings us all back to Palm Sunday. And in John 12, we get some extra information about why this Palm Sunday crowd had gathered. This is John 12, verses 17 and 18. It tells us that it was because of the raising of Lazarus. The people have heard of this great miracle that Jesus called into the tomb of his friend Lazarus, and Lazarus came out from the tomb alive. It says, the reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they had heard he had done this sign. Just as we heard in Matthew chapter 4, fame had spread about Jesus. And this brings us full circle to Palm Sunday. The signs he performed, which pointed him to being Messiah, had made Jesus famous and known throughout the land. And here he is, coming into Jerusalem, the Savior who would free us. Yet we know how this story ends, and the same crowd that is cheering him in a few days is going to be the same crowd that yells, "Crucify, crucify." How quickly things change. You see, the question for us is how do we view Jesus? Someone who will give us things, like a genie when we need it? Or maybe somebody to save us from our external problems, but not really address the sin that is inside us? You see, some follow Jesus because of an expected political victory. Some follow it because they were curious. What are you looking for? Are you like those who, after being fed, only wanted more physical bread from Jesus? Many believers today, they follow Jesus for what they can get from him, to justify their prejudice, to support their own politics, and to conform to their own culture. Kenneth Grangell says that how common in our day to see Christians attempting to substitute spiritual power with some false and useless modern ideal. We look for spiritual power in politics, signs and wonders, size and influence, spiritual warfare, or even popular celebrities. We look to these other solutions when John here says that we need to point to Christ. Jesus has so much more to offer than this world. You see, Jesus is the promised Messiah, the one who came to restore the brokenness in our lives because of sin. Sin is at the root of all of our problems. Jesus was coming into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday for victory, but it was a victory unexpected. Not a military or political victory, but a victory gained from being nailed to a cross. Jesus would have victory over sin and death. Remember what Jesus asked his disciples about the crowds in Luke 19? Beginning in verse 18, he asked them, "Who are the crowds? What do they say about me?" Disciples say, "Well, some say you're John the Baptist, others say Elijah, some people say another prophet." And then he turns to his disciples and he says, "But who do you say I am?" And Peter, in full confidence, says, "The Christ of God," or the Messiah of God. And there it is. There's the answer we're all looking for. So I have the same question to you. Who is Jesus? When we figure out that answer, our lives will be different. And in fact, in that same passage where Peter gives that great confession, Jesus talks about those who will follow him. He says, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." He says, look, if you lose your life, you will gain it. That is the path that we take as believers. You know, in reciting how he was saved, Ironside was sharing an interaction he had with some friends after he was saved. And his friends came to him and they asked him, "Harry, what do you mean by turning religious? You're throwing your life away." Ironside responded, he says, "Why, that's just what I intended to do, to throw my life away. Have you lost your life for the sake of Christ? Today we have taken a journey this Palm Sunday. We have seen the day Jesus comes riding into Jerusalem with great celebration. We have seen how the expectations had confused Israel over their Messiah. We have also seen how these great crowds gathered and loved the signs that he performed and the physical gifts that he gave him. Both missed why he really came and who he really was. I pray that those listening to my voice do not make the same mistake. Repent and turn to Christ." Now, I want to come back to that story of my cousin, because it didn't end with sadness. Our family was just having some fun with our cousin. And after he had opened all those gifts and been disappointed, he realized there was one more gift. And I think once he realized there was one more gift, he knew what it was. And he opened that with excitement, and finally he had his scooter. He had found what he was looking for. He had found what he had been wanting all that time. And what joy there is in heaven when we find Christ. When we repent and turn to him for our lives. But see, I also know that there are those who I'm talking to that already know Christ. I asked you to be encouraged by these words. And yes, while he didn't come to rule, he's coming again. And he will establish his kingship. And he will rule over this world. Scripture tells us that for 1,000 years, he will set up his kingdom and he will rule here on earth. Take heart for all that Christ has done for us. And in those times of great trials and separation that we face today, look to Jesus. Do not look to the things of this world for your comfort, but instead focus your hope and your life on Christ. I posted a quote on Facebook that said, "If life has reduced you to realize that God is your only hope, well then life has done you a favor. Lean on that hope." Faith Fellowship Church, rejoice in this Palm Sunday of our Messiah, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray, and then Alex will close us with a song. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time of coming together, this time of looking to the scriptures of Palm Sunday, of realizing your Messiahship, that you are our Savior. Lord, help us to not be like these crowds that just followed you for what they could get or what they could see. But may we be people who seek after you, who want our lives changed by your Spirit, Lord. And then, Lord, we look forward to great expectations of you coming again, of you ridding this world of the sin that infests it. Lord, we await your second coming, but as we wait, we know that we still have work to do. Lord, be with us this day. Strengthen us, encourage us. And again, we pray for those who are on the front lines of this battle, who are trying to contain this virus. Lord, we pray for your help. Lord, be with us. Strengthen us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Faith Fellowship.
Thank you, Seth. That was great. We're going to sing a couple more songs to close out our service this morning, guys. I was reading some old C.S. Lewis, looking through some old books recently, and it reminded me of one of my favorite quotes, I think, from C.S. Lewis. Not really a quote, but a part of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, when all of the children are first hearing about Aslan for the first time. They're talking to the beavers, and the beavers are describing who he is, and then they find out that he's a lion. And one of the kids asks, "Is he a tame lion?" And the beavers say, no, no one ever said anything about tame, but he is good. That's such a cool picture of what God is to us. He is all-powerful and all-knowing and could whip the earth up in fire like that, you know? He's not tame, but he is good. And so I thought we'd sing this song, Good, Good Father, to kind of think about who God is to us right now and always, despite what a lot of people may be saying or feeling or thinking in a time like this when it feels like we're on our own as a world. but he is still very much our Father and our friend. So we're going to sing a couple songs. We're going to sing Good, Good Father, and then What a Friend We Have in Jesus, to kind of reset our minds going into this week and really focus on who God is and who he is to us. So let's sing Good, Good Father first.
Love in the dead of night.
Everybody, we will see you on Friday for a Good Friday service, and then again for Easter. Be sure to check the website for the times that those services are taking place. See you then.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and love. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Upon